Ladies and gentlemen, please take your seats. The program will begin shortly. Ladies and gentlemen, please take your seats. Welcome. Welcome to Women for Women International's 2023 Luncheon. Please welcome your host and moderator, Penny Abeywardena. Penny is a women's rights advocate, the former commissioner for international affairs for the city of New York, and currently a Forbes contributing columnist.
Hi, everyone. Welcome. We got some good New York City weather. It was all meant to be for right now. I am so delighted to welcome all of you to Women for Women International's 2023 Luncheon. I'm very excited to be this year's host and moderator because my relationship with Women for Women goes back to 2009 when I was running the Girls and Women's Program at the Clinton Global Initiative, and I first started working with Zainab Salbi. Zainab, where are you at? There she is. It's been extraordinary to watch the growth and impact over the years. I've admired this organization for a very long time, and to be asked to be host this year is a tremendous honor. It is their 30th anniversary. Hi. It's incredible. And as many of you know, and if you don't know, the core mission of Women for Women International is close to my heart and hopefully yours. But it's been close to my heart because I've spent much of my career advocating for women's rights and social justice. I know all too well the systemic barriers and discrimination that women face from the workplace to healthcare to access to education and in politics. It seems like every day we hear of a new attack on women's rights somewhere in the world. Our voices are being silenced and our contributions undervalued. 1 in 3 of us have experienced some form of violence. 12 million girls are married before the age of 18 every year, and that is 22 girls per minute. And at the current rate of progress, it will take 132 years to close the gender gap. These are stark figures, sober and alarming in equal measure. And it only gets worse for women in conflict-affected regions, with nearly 50 million women forced to flee their homes across the globe. We know the needs of women and girls are often overlooked during times of crisis and conflict, and they are at heightened risk for so many things, including sexual violence, domestic abuse, trafficking, child marriage, while bearing the additional responsibility of caring for their families. These are the women survivors of war Women for Women International serve. In today's luncheon, we want to recognize the immense hardship and trauma they face, but we also want to celebrate their extraordinary resilience, their hope, and their ability to reclaim their own power despite what has happened to them. As a woman, as someone who spent her childhood undocumented, as a survivor of domestic violence, power to me means having the ability to have autonomy over our own body, our career choices, and our movement. That is my hope for all people around the world. Now, what does reclaiming their power look like for the hundreds of thousands of women survivors of war that Women for Women International has supported over the last 30 years? I'm excited to talk about this. A little later today, we're gonna have an incredible panel up here. We have Varina Winder, Deputy Senior Official and Senior Advisor in the Secretary's Office of Global Women's Issues at the U.S. State Department, Sara Wahedi, CEO and Founder of Ehtesab, a civic technology, I did not pronounce that properly, I apologize, a civic technology startup that provides security and city service alerts to Afghans, and Amjad, Atallah, co-founder and co-chair of the Global Board of Directors for Women International. Now, before that, we are gonna hear from our CEO, Lori Adams. She is gonna tell us about some of the incredible women at the heart of this mission. And we will see a special film premiere of Beginning in Bosnia, the story of how this organization was founded nearly three decades ago. First, though, I'd like to introduce, it is my privilege to introduce Adi Oasis, who will kick off our luncheon with a special performance. Adi is a New York City-based French-Caribbean singer, bassist, and producer. Her music fuses soul, funk, and R&B to form her own distinctive retro-futuristic sound. And if you like the sound of that, she has a new album, Lotus Glow, which is out now. Please join me in welcoming Adi Oasis.
Hi, it's an honor to be here. This is a song about claiming that it's time to put women in positions of power to be valued and appreciated. So I hope you enjoy the music. Thank you for inviting me. Keys. I'm done with people pleasing. together. You know now it's our turn. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Adi. That was beautiful. Can we give her another round of applause, please? Now, most of you know Lori Adams, who has been the CEO of Women for Women International for the past 7 years. But for those of you who don't, she's also a lifelong women's rights advocate devoted to eradicating all forms of injustice and inequality. She has lived and worked in 4 different countries in a multicultural and multiracial family, figuring out how best to bring about the change and build organizations with feminists around the world. So please welcome us, Lori Adams.
So I'm going to start by thanking Adi for that beautiful performance, and also Penny for your warm welcome. Thank you very much. We're so pleased that you could both join us today, as well as our wonderful speakers who you'll be hearing from soon. Wow, what a fantastic crowd this is. I am so thrilled to see so many familiar faces, but also so many new ones. It's fantastic to be here with our co-chairs and our co-founders, and we'll be hearing from them soon. I want to give a shout out to our luncheon committee, including Faria, Mona, Kelly. But there's one particular woman on the luncheon committee, of course, and that is Dale Berger, that I want to acknowledge. She has been a power force behind this event for over a decade, deciding programs, testing menus, filling tables. She doesn't love the spotlight, so we've never managed to get her up on this table, and I'm not even gonna make her stand up. However, I think those of you who know her know that she is one incredible woman, incredibly kind and compassionate, so the staff are all adore working with you, Dale, but also so determined for our cause. So as we mark 9 years of board leadership, I want to thank you for your and Max's support. With it, we have enrolled literally tens of thousands of women in our program. You've made an incredible difference. So please, a round of applause for Dale. So that's one of our stalwarts, but there's also somebody new in the room, some new people in the room that I need to acknowledge. As a personal fangirl, I can't help but point out that Tunde and Chelsea are in the room. Now, for those of you who don't know them, these are two incredible Peloton instructors who have a global following. Tens of thousands of people join their classes every day, including me. And so these two women got me through the lockdown on the yoga mat and on the bike. But it's not just about exercise, because they both bring a women's empowerment, a black empowerment theme to their classes. And that's what we're here about today. We're here about power. Tunde also just released a book called Speak, which is all about power. So two examples of the incredible people in this room, old and new. So thank you for joining us. So thank you to each and every one of you for joining us here today. As we've already heard, it is our 30th anniversary. It's also our 13th luncheon. So a really momentous occasion for all of us. And many of you have been here many times, and we really thank you for coming back. Now, for those of you who are new to us, I'm going to take a few minutes to describe what we do. And we work, as you know, in some of the most difficult and dangerous places to be a woman. Countries like Afghanistan, Iraq, Syria, northern Nigeria, Ukraine, and more. While we often respond in acute conflicts with emergency trauma support that we deliver through partners, what makes us truly unique is that we stay for the long term, helping women to rebuild their lives, their families, and their communities. How exactly do we do this? By equipping women with the knowledge, the skills, and the resources they need to claim their own social and economic power. Through our 12-month Stronger Women, Stronger Nations program, we organize women into groups of 25 who meet weekly to learn things like how to earn and save money, how to improve their health and well-being, how to influence decisions in their homes and in their communities. These groups connect them to lifelong networks for support. In countries where there is still acute conflict, like Ukraine, or tragically now also Sudan, we identify and work with local partners to meet the most immediate needs, including trauma counseling. What's different about our approach, whether directly or with partners, is that it's always led and implemented by local people who understand the issues deeply that women face in those communities and who know the best way to bring about long-lasting change. Our greatest strength is we meet women where they are at. We amplify their voices and experiences, and we adapt our programs to meet their needs. Now, we have robust measurement about the impact of our program. We've been recognized by the World Bank as best in class. Bloomberg Philanthropies, who have supported us for over a decade, have just done a rigorous, independent evaluation of our work over 10 years with John Hopkins. Mike Bloomberg himself will be personally releasing later this month the results of this evaluation. And it further validates the phenomenal results of the program. Our graduates more than double their income. They more than triple their savings than they did at the start of the program. Most importantly for me, they double their decision-making rights. Now being able to have a say in how many children to have, whether their girls go to school, what kind of work they do where. There's an internal transformation that happens to a woman when she's put in touch with her own power, when she's filled with confidence rather than shame, when she has connections for support, other women that she can lean on. And that is the heart and soul of Women for Women International, our deep belief in the power of women coming together to break the isolation of war and rebuild not just their own lives, but that of their families and communities. And it's with that belief and that knowledge that Women for Women International was founded 30 years ago by Zainab Salbi and Amjad Atallah. Last November, I was able to go to with Zainab to Sarajevo, back to where it all began. And she introduced me to Taiba, a survivor with a particularly harrowing experience of war. I'd like to share that story with you in this short film here today. In the early 90s, war started in Bosnia after the fall of Yugoslavia, a federation of Balkan states. Bosnian Muslims were driven from their homes. Rape was used as a weapon of war. I'd gone back with Zainab Salbi to hear how 30 years ago, as a young Iraqi immigrant studying in Washington, D.C., she and her husband, Amjad Atallah, were so horrified by scenes of this war in Europe that they were compelled to act.
I was 23 years old, and Amjad, the co-founder of Women for Women International, Amjad Atallah, was 27 years old. We were demonstrating because of the war in Bosnia. There was injustice, there were rape camps, there were concentration camps. And we knew we have to do something about it. Then we went around and realize we're not the only ones who want to help. There are lots of people who want to help. We don't have much money, so we wanted to help in small ways. You know, that's the only thing we could. So we created the sponsorship program where we asked every woman to sponsor one woman at a time by sending her money and letters and pictures. We did not know anybody in Sarajevo, so we, through a friend who was at the Bosnian embassy, who was an activist, she said, I have my mother, why don't you stay with her in Sarajevo? I meet her mother, who was a piano teacher, Farida Mushanovic. And she then, this piano teacher and the head of the music school, started becoming our first Women for Women International, you know, volunteer. Then we found a way to get her the money and the letters in her house. She translated the letters with her sister, went to refugee camps, or the woman came to her house, gave them the money, exchanged the pictures and the letters, and that's how it started.
On that first trip, Zainab, with the Bosnian volunteers, helped 30 women. And that was the beginning of the organization I now lead. Coming back to Bosnia made us reflect in different ways. For me, to see how far Women for Women International has come since it began 30 years ago. For Zainab, reuniting with the woman with whom she shared the intensity of those early days has been really moving. To reconnect with Saida Sarek, the first country director in Bosnia, again, after so long, was particularly poignant for Zainab.
I don't have sisters, biological sisters, and so all the women I worked with in my tenure at Women for Women became my sisters, and Saida was the first one.
Today, Saida still leads our Bosnian organization, Zena za Zena. They not only continue supporting women survivors of the Bosnian War, but also run a democracy academy for a new generation.
Teaching young women, we believe that we are teaching entire community because they are our future and they are ones who need to understand absolutely what is democracy.
I remember when I attended the Academy of Democracy, the one thing that like stuck in my head, like we are a community of over half a million of people, and women, strong women.
I'd been to Bosnia before, but this was the first time I'd visited this piece of the country's past. This cramped tunnel was a lifeline when the city of Sarajevo was under siege. The citizens dug a tunnel so that food and medical supplies could reach the desperate people who were trapped. It became known as the Tunnel of Hope.
Saida, how long did it take to like walk this tunnel?
It depend really, it was in between 30 minutes and 1 hour.
Like this?
Really depend how busy it is. Is it just one side or both sides coming and passing? And Lauren,
and?
This is the way how our letters and money came to Sarajevo and letters from Sarajevo to Washington, D.C.
30 years later, millions of people killed. This place from Bosnia, I mean, this is Women for Women International followed all the wars. And you would think the world would have changed and would have understood that wars do not work and that raping of women in war or in any time must stop and it's a war crime. And here we are.
Exactly.
30 years later in Ukraine, you know, it's the same. It's the same thing. It's unbelievable how people do not learn the lessons from the past.
A couple hours drive from Sarajevo is the village of Amici in the Lasva Valley. There, we met with Taiba, a survivor with a particularly harrowing experience of the war. She showed us into the house that's been in her family for decades. And then she sat down to talk with me and Zainab.
Ti jedeš se 93. u ranim jutranjim časovima.
In the early morning.
Napadnuto je moje selo.
My village was attacked.
и 116 моих комшија, люди, жена, деца, убиено е.
What Taiba witnessed was a massacre. She and her family became refugees in another village.
Onda sam ja babi rekla, babo, ja odoh do tog sela što smo bili smješteni, tu ću prije saznati, jer su dole dolazile strašne vijesti da je sve što je ostalo izginulo, da je žene spadale u nesvijest, ovo, ono. Ja sam morala da saznam šta je sa mojim tim sestrama, njihovom djecom, ljudima. I povratku u selo saznajem da je moja jedna sestra u zarobljeništvu s djecom i s mužem, a druga sestra moja je ona izbjegla u Travnik.
Years later, after the war was over, they returned to Amici. Other women returned too, most of them widows who'd lost husbands, sons, brothers in the massacre.
Jednog lijepog dana u naše selo stiže vijest, još ljepša vijest, da u selo dolazi organizacija Women's for Women, koja želi da vrati žene tehnici, da ih nauči nekim tehnikama nešto. Tada se u meni, lično u meni, probudio nekakav prkos da se život pobijedi. I tada je došla ideja da osnovimo udruženje žena koje se zove Ahmičanke, koji danas dan postoji.
What Taiba did, what the women in her group did, they started small farms and sewing collectives. They moved forward.
There are many women around the world who are suffering. What's your message to them?
Žene su snažne, Boga.
Women are very powerful.
Zeynep started this mission. We who take on the torch from her at Women for Women International will keep on working as hard as we can. As Zeynep says, there's never been a greater need.
Don't thank me, don't thank you. Just help another woman, and another woman, and another woman, and another woman, and help her financially, and emotionally, and spiritually, and every way you know. But keep on doing that, and that is, you know, the butterfly effect. That is the sisterhood effect. That is the unstoppable effect that no army, no government, no fascist regime, no militias, no war, nothing can stop that power.
This is actually my job. Watching that film just reminded me how lucky I am. So I'd now like to take a moment to acknowledge our founder, Zeynep Salbi. Please stand up. And Amjad Atallah, for you as well. Zeynep and Amjad, it is such a privilege and an honor to continue to work with this organization that you created. Amjad, we are so very, very grateful that you have returned to serve on the board as our co-chair. And Zeynep, even though this organization has evolved in some important ways, it remains the heart and soul that you created, and your original vision remains absolutely relevant today as it was 30 years ago. Because you both realize that women survivors of war have very specific needs that weren't and still are not being met by the rest of the international NGO community. And you decided to change that. You trusted local women from the very start to know their own needs, putting cash directly in their hands. Nobody was doing that 30 years ago. You created a model of solidarity so that we can all be part of this transformation. And now, 30 years later, because of that, more than 500,000 women have had their lives directly transformed in conflict zones all over the world. Each of those women taking up the call and passing on what they learned to their families and their communities. So thank you, Zainab, and thank you, Amjad, for your courage and your vision. You're both a true inspiration to us all. So as I reflect on how far Women for Women International has come since we began 30 years ago, I can't help but continue to be inspired by the continued power and relevance of the original vision, as I've said. But I also feel a sense of pride at how we've continuously evolved and improved our work based on rigorous evaluations and, very importantly, based on listening to what women tell us. Over just the last 5 years, we've more than doubled the number of countries we work in, from 8 to 17, primarily through partners who are at the front lines of working in acute conflict zones and who we work with because they share our values and our approach. One such partner that I was able to meet recently is the Mariupol Women's Association. This organization is led by a mother-daughter team who are both themselves refugees. One, a lawyer, the other, a trauma specialist. When they were forced to leave Mariupol in Ukraine, they evacuated 220 women with them. What struck me most in talking to them is how, despite losing absolutely everything, not only their homes and how they lived, but the entire city wiped out. No place really to return to that would ever be familiar. Katurenia and Marna still have hope. And what they do is give not only practical support, but also hope to those hundreds of women that they serve with our support. Katerina told me later, when we were doing an online event together, what gives me hope is women's solidarity. Because the Russian military, they have huge weapons like winter and violence, but we have a weapon too, and that is our solidarity and our unity. My time with the Ukrainian women in Warsaw filled me with hope and inspiration. And I am determined that we stand by them until this terrible conflict is over and they can go home. Just last month, I visited our program in South Sudan. South Sudan is the world's newest country, separated from Sudan in 2011 after 20 years of a brutal war that killed millions and displaced millions more. A country already impoverished by hundreds of years of slave trade and colonialism has been further devastated by fighting between its own leaders. And now, as a similar power struggle between military leaders in neighboring Sudan escalates, innocent people in both countries continue to bear the brunt of the conflict. They say that when the elephants fight, it's the grass that gets trampled. And in war, as we know, it is the women and children who suffer the most. And in this part of the world, that suffering is extreme, because rape as a weapon of war and sexual violence more broadly are rampant. The United Nations Commission on Human Rights in South Sudan said in a report last year that overall women and girls live a hellish existence. We can't let the same happen to women in Sudan. That's why we are beginning to work with partners in Sudan to help meet the most urgent needs of Sudanese women. And that is why our work in South Sudan is so important. In stark contrast to the horrific statistics and history I had read, the women I met in our program in Juba and Yei were absolutely full of joy and hope. We were dancing all the time. There was one trainer, Grace, who particularly impressed me during the trip. Grace had suffered unspeakable trauma herself, yet she found the strength to pick herself up, and she now works as a trainer in our program. Her proudest moment, she explained to me, was when a participant who had lost all hope, and whom frankly everyone else said was beyond redemption, managed to come out of her despair, regain her hope through Grace's coaching and training, and through the solidarity she built with the other women in the program. Grace told me how proud she was because she felt that it was her own story of surviving that enabled this participant to believe that she could also survive. And so she was able to save herself with our support. Grace is determined to continue helping woman after woman reconnect to their strength and power, overcome despair with hope, and rebuild their lives. I'm so inspired by Grace's commitment and passion and carry that with me today. So in the past 7 years, I've witnessed countless women like Grace, like Taiba, who go through our program, gain their confidence, build their businesses, and also build a meaningful community of love and support with each other. This is what the power of women in solidarity can do. This is the sisterhood effect. It rebuilds lives, it fosters hope, and it transforms communities. Wars can destroy cities, tear down buildings, ravage lives. But once you invest in a woman and she gains the confidence to realize her power, there is no renewed conflict or setback that can take away that power, that education from her. What's more, she'll use that knowledge to rebuild. It's the investment in women that endures, that rebuilds societies from the ground up. Everywhere I went in Yei and South Sudan, and I visited over a dozen different classes and businesses, the women thanked us profusely, proudly shared their success stories, and urged us to expand the program further so that their sisters could benefit as they have. One such woman is Lilius Anita. In one of the classrooms I visited, remember a class is usually 25 people, there were over 200 people. "What's going on?" I asked. "I don't know," her colleague said. They were as surprised as I was. It turned out the word had gotten out that the CEO was in town, and these women had showed up to say, "We want to be enrolled too." Lily raised her hand. She came forward. I think she was probably over 70 years old, but she walked and spoke with energy. She explained that she had just returned back from Uganda, the neighboring country, where she had been a refugee. She'd heard about our program and its impact on women, and she wanted to enroll. "Please create more places for me and my sisters," she said, meaning the hundreds of other women who'd also just returned from Uganda and want to rebuild. So today, I bring you Lily's appeal, all the way from South Sudan. Help us reach millions, not thousands, of women. Help us reach women like Lily in the coming years. Yes, it's an ambitious goal we have at Women for Women International. You just heard our founding story, so you see it's in our DNA. With each of you in this room joining us, I am confident that we can do it. Reach millions of women, one Taiba, one Lily at a time. I'm constantly energized by what happens when women come together and realize our inherent power. Every person in this room today has the power to help women like Lily. I humbly ask you that you help us further our mission by considering a donation. For every $400, we can roll another woman into our program. For every $10,000, we can start a new class in the countries we work, and those women will support each other forever. You've already given us the gift of your time by coming today, and I ask you to consider taking that extra step and making a pledge. There are several ways you can give. You can use the donation envelopes that are on your tables. We have iPads available in the room, and there are staff throughout, so just let someone know and they can bring it to you. And there's also a QR code at the back of the program brochure, which you can use your phone for. So on behalf of everyone at Women for Women International and Lily, I thank you for joining us today. Please enjoy your lunch, followed by what's going to be an even more inspiring conversation with our speakers just after.
Oh, no. I thought I was introducing them. Oh, I'm sorry. My bad.
Ladies and gentlemen, may we have your attention? Our panel discussion will begin shortly.
And I think shortly is now. I hope lunch was great, everyone. It is such a pleasure to be on stage with these three amazing speakers we are going to jump into a conversation with. Right now, to my immediate left is Varina Winder, Senior Advisor in the Secretary's Office of Global Women's Issues at the State Department. Varina has extensive experience in gender-based violence, women and girls' health, and multilateral affairs. We have Sara Wahedi, CEO and founder of Ehtesab, a civic technology startup for Afghans. I found out the name of her company means accountability and transparency. Sara was named one of Time Magazine's Next Gen Leaders. As well. We need them, yes. We need you. As well as one of the BBC's top 100 women for her work in democratizing access to information for Afghans. And of course, we have Amjad, Atallah, co-founder and co-chair of the Global Board of Directors at Women for Women International, and he is currently the managing director of Doha Debates. He has decades of experience as a legal advisor and policy expert, and he has worked in human rights all over the world with an emphasis on addressing violence against women in wartime. I'm gonna jump into this conversation with Amjad, but something I want you guys all to be prepared for is that we have woven in some time for Q&A, and we really want you guys to engage with us up here on stage. So after this first round of questions, I'm gonna be looking at you to ask them the hard questions. Now Amjad, we earlier saw the extraordinary stories of Taiba, Katrina, and Grace. What has stayed with you 30 years later from your time in Sarajevo when you first co-founded Women for Women?
So that was an amazing video, but 30 years ago was a long time ago, and a lot of you may not have remembered exactly what was happening in Sarajevo. The city had been under siege for the longest time of any city since World War II, and it was without electricity, it was without water. It can be brutally cold in the winter. There were snipers on those hills that you were seeing in the video. Sarajevo is nestled in a valley, and the hills around it, there were snipers. The snipers were being paid bounties for each man, woman, and child that they murdered. And it was in that world that, so two stories about women and one story about a man, quickly. So it was in that situation that Zainab went into the city. Mm. Everybody else was trying to get out of the city. And Zainab, who doesn't have a sense of fear, went in with UN troops into the city and met Farida to start the program. Farida Masanovic, as Zainab said, was a music teacher at the university, and she was a piano teacher. She had continued teaching her classes despite the fact that there was no water, there was no electricity, because she felt that culture was what they were trying to destroy. Mm. The people who were besieging the city were trying to destroy everything that made life beautiful, including music, and so she insisted on continuing to teach. And then she added to that, providing the money and the letters that we were gathering and sending to Sarajevo. But each time that she did that, she was literally risking her life. Every time she stepped out of her home and she went to another center where women were gathered, she was risking her life. And she did that for the entirety of the war. The other story is that the first time I got to Sarajevo was right after the war, and we were going around to villages outside of Sarajevo, gathering people together to enroll them in the program. And so women, as you've heard in the video, and this happens in every country we go to, women hear that an organization is coming. They don't know exactly what it's gonna do, but they know it's gonna help women, and they wanna be there, and they wanna be part of it. And so women were showing up in this farmhouse, and we were all sitting around a picnic table. And a woman named Natasha, who was working with us, one of the great things about Women for Women is that we were non-sectarian. And so the women that we had working in the organization were Bosnian, Muslim, Bosnian, Croat, Bosnian, mm-hmm. Serb. And so you had Catholics, Orthodox Christians, and Muslims working together as survivors. And so Natasha, you know, was doing the presentation, and a very elderly man stooped over, came in, sat with us, and he had these Coke bottle glasses that are, you know, like you remember from the cartoons. And he said, is this the organization that's helping women? And Natasha joked with him, and she said, yes, but you're not a woman. And he said, I'm here for my wife, but she's ill today and she couldn't come. Mm. And she said, she continued to tease him, and she said, well, you know, she's gonna have to attend the meetings if we have them, and you know, you're not gonna be able to attend on her behalf. And he said, well, you know, we're from Srebrenica, and Srebrenica was where the worst genocide since World War II happened in Europe. And when the Serb forces took over the city from the UN soldiers told us they wouldn't be able to protect us, and they told us to run into the forest. So we ran into the forest, and it was night, and I tripped, and I fell, and I broke my glasses. So I sat down, and I told her, go without me. And she sat down next to me, and she said, no, I'm not gonna go without you. You're gonna come with me. We're both gonna survive. And she put me on her back, and she carried me to the next village. So if I have to carry her to every one of your meetings, I will carry her to every one of your meetings. Now, so she was enrolled in the program. So those people who had undergone that horror, yeah, then saw that the Rwanda genocide happened. And they were among the first to tell us and to insist to us, we have to help in Rwanda. Some of them told us we would never have thought of that before the genocide here. We would not have thought that, we would have thought of Rwanda as something far away. Mm-hmm. Now we see it's the same thing. Mm. And Saida was one of the first people to call me up when Ukraine was invaded, Saida Sarach, who you saw, and said, we know exactly what the women in Ukraine are going through. We need to be involved, and we need to help them. And so for me, what was so inspiring is that 30 years ago, these people were survivors of the most horrible thing on earth. But they not only survived, they became the people helping people in other places as well, while they're still undergoing their own concerns. It's not like Bosnia is a secure and safe environment quite yet. And so they're able to actually see the world. They're able to see that solidarity and that sisterhood that Zainab saw from the very first day. And so for me, that's always been the most inspiring part of what I remember of that trip 30 years ago.
That was extraordinary. Thank you for sharing that. A reminder that when you can interact with people who do such heroic things, it stays with you. It doesn't matter how much time. Varina, it's, I think, really important to talk about the role that government has. And I do think it's a really big deal that the US Department of State has a global, an Office of Global Women's Issues. It's not that old, right? If you can also mention about how, exactly. But can you talk about your mandate to promote women's rights? And how do the direct experiences of women and the stories that we just heard influence the way that the government can provide solutions?
Yeah, so I think I'm the bureaucratic plant on this panel.
We need you.
And I will try not to give any, I was saying last night, I would try not to give any talking points, but just to talk like a normal human being who happens to work in government. And I should start by really saying thank you. Thank you to all of you who enable the civil society work to continue, because I think it's really important to talk about what government can do, and sometimes what we can't do is where civil society picks in and takes us that last mile, sort of that carries you through the woods at the most opportune time. So I want to answer that question, but I want to talk a little bit about what the mandate is and how we do it and how we achieve it and how we work with women and with women-led organizations and with civil society and with men sometimes too, because they are actually really a critical part of the solution. So my office was started in 2009 under then Secretary Hillary Clinton. And our mandate is to integrate gender equity, gender equality, the rights of women and girls into the conduct of US foreign policy. And so I joke usually not in front of a crowd and definitely not in front of reporters. But I joke that our job is essentially to show up and barge through the door if we haven't been invited, and to bring our folding chair, if you all know that reference, and to sit down at the table where the discussions are being had about, okay, well, how are we gonna evacuate Sudan? Oop. I'm gonna hold on to this. I have fake pockets, not real pockets. How are we gonna evacuate Sudan? How are we gonna think about the G20, right? Like, or how are we gonna integrate women's issues into the G20? Have we thought about how this might actually disproportionately or differentially affect women and girls? Oh, that conversation is not about this. Oh, well, it's a good thing I'm here, and we have some ideas. And we have some people you can talk to who also have some ideas. So we're beloved. So what does that do? What is the work is actually, I think of it as sort of a three-legged stool. It's policy, development, prioritization, right? Government isn't doing, can't do all things at once. So how do we develop our policies, and then how do we prioritize them? It's programming, which I think many of you in the room will be really familiar with, having known some of Women for Women's work. And then it's diplomacy. So in policy, I'll try to just give an example of how we work with women or women-led organizations or just individuals in all three prongs. So when it comes to policy, some of you may know the Biden administration, for the first time, this is the first time the U.S. has ever had a U.S. strategy on gender equity and gender equality. And this strategy is domestic and international. I, of course, work on the international side. And it identifies sort of 10 overarching interconnected priorities that we should be working on if we ever want to achieve gender equality. I think you stated the Global Gap Gender Report at the beginning, 132 years. Actually, pre-COVID, it was under 100 years. So in just a span of 2 years, we've gone from less than 100 years to 132 years. We are not making progress. We are going backwards. And in my office, we have sort of three areas of main policy that we work on: gender-based violence, women, peace, and security, which, of course, is very much aligned with Women for Women, and women's economic security. And just as an example, we launched our global gender-based violence strategy in December, I believe. That strategy was developed, yes, in-house among all of the sort of foreign policy agency offices. So our office led that effort. But we also talked to more than 450 individuals from more than 60 countries representing hundreds of organizations as we developed that strategy. And we didn't do that strategy, and we didn't talk to those, you know, they weren't consultations for consultation's sake. They were really like, no, really, what should we be doing? And out of that, I mean, you will see that imprint in the strategy if you ever wanted to read it. It is dry government talk. But, you know, what came up over and over and over again, for example, was, you know, online gender-based violence is actually a huge issue, and it's a democracy issue, and it's a real, you know, I don't distinguish between I'm going to come and rape you if I hear it online or if I hear that in the street. Like, I'm going to take that seriously. So we centered that in the strategy, and that's one way where women's voices and women-led organizations is actually centered in our policy. Two, on the programming side, we are, and by we, I mean not the U.S. State Department, but my specific office, we're a bit of a unique office in that we're a policy office and we're also a programming office. And so we have about $10 million a year that we give out in foreign assistance, which is large and also very, very small when you compare that to USAID. And so what we're able to do is actually a little bit different than what some foreign assistance can do. We actually have made it so that we actually talk to a lot of women-led organizations and grassroots-led organizations and community-based, locally-led organizations as we're developing our proposals. So we don't come in and say, well, you know, in Sudan, we think that the solution is gonna be this. We actually have partners on the ground in Sudan, and we'll go in and we'll talk to them and say, like, well, like, this is the idea that we're kicking around, and can you help us refine it further? And you don't have to give us your tax ID number and your DINs and your this and, you know, 10 years of tax statements to have that conversation. Like, let's kick it around together. And so that has actually developed, and it's relatively new that we're doing that. But again, you know, because civil society sees and can do things that we don't necessarily see or can do. I think Afghanistan, we're going to talk about that in a minute, is a really good example, so I'm really excited to hear what you have to say. We now have programs in about 60 countries, and a lot of it's becoming more and more and more, like really partner-led, women-led organizations. Lastly, on diplomacy, and I'm sure my time is running short here, but on diplomacy, diplomacy is sort of the bread and butter of what we do. It does not look at all like what Carrie Russell does. I don't know if anybody else is watching that show. I am watching that show and screaming at it and saying, like, they would never be driving around in a Range Rover. It is not an American man's car. That would never happen. My husband's like, shh. But diplomacy is the bread and butter of what we do. I have the joy and privilege of coming up here. We get to talk to the UN. We get to center that in our multilateral. We travel a lot. We talk to bilateral governments. And part of that travel and part of what we do is, you know, when we go and we talk to a government, we say, well, we also want to talk to civil society. Can you help us? Oh, you don't know anybody. Oh, we happen to know some people at civil society. Can you also invite them in to this meeting? And can we talk to, you know? And so we try to use that platform strategically in order to get to the women leaders who we know aren't necessarily at the table. They're still banging on the door outside. And the last, and I think one of the most powerful ways that we do that is through our public diplomacy. I think we have media in the room, and I think telling stories is part of what I think really helps. We do a big event every year in Washington, D.C. called the International Women of Courage Award, and I'm seeing some heads nod in the room. We identify, with the help of our embassies and our posts around the world, approximately 10 or so women who are doing, you know, work like what Grace is doing, work that is incredibly, you know, anti-corruption or children's rights or refugee assistance, in journalists who are doing just work that is incredibly, incredibly, incredibly challenging, usually at great risk, at great personal risk, at great familiar risk to themselves. And we basically bring them to Washington and we build them a stage like this, and then we ask them to take the mic and speak to themselves, or speak for themselves. And I think that's part of why I can sort of be proud of the work that we do, is because at the end of the day, like, we're just the foundation. They can climb on top of our backs and give the speech themselves.
Thank you. And that is like a very important part of the foundation of moving this agenda along. Sara, you represent a lot, but for me, it's the gen right now that's helping us get to where we need to get to. Afghanistan has gone through so much. I would love for you to talk a little bit about your organization, but then pivot into what the needs are on the ground right now, what you're seeing, how a room full of people who care about this issue can be helpful.
Amazing, yeah, thank you so much for having me. I guess I'll start off by a conversation that I just had with one of your esteemed board members. And we both spoke about our love and, I guess, depressive stay for Afghanistan. And he has been and was at IRC for over a decade, and we spoke about our time in Afghanistan. And one of the main things that continues to be the main part of the conversation is this focus on keeping Afghans fed and sheltered. That is the end of the conversation, and I can give an example of that. So I manage a tech startup called Ehtesab, and it's a cognate use of words, as Penny mentioned, that means accountability and transparency. Our annual budget overhead is $30,000. And with that, we have been able to send near real-time alerts to all 34 provinces in Afghanistan. We've been able to collect reports from women, from girls, from youth about school closures, about roadblocks, about Talib sentiments, just for $30,000, which probably you may be spending on rent. And for me, it's that these conversations aren't happening because no one wants to talk about Afghanistan past food and shelter. Because right now the impetus is that in the Ukraine, there is an app like the one that I manage, which gets millions of dollars. But the ones in Afghanistan don't, because the world doesn't think that we're ready. And now that they see the Taliban regime in, they think, what's really the point other than keeping you fed? And that's why the cyclical failure continues to happen in countries like Afghanistan, because we're not seen as viable, efficient people on this earth. And I say that as a realist, I say that as a technologist. I'm not a diplomat, so I don't speak in jargon. I speak for what the situation actually is right now. And I wish I had your skill, because I think that that's one of the things you need really to get through these big rooms. But my reasoning for speaking so bluntly with you as fellow women is that I think you will understand where I'm coming from. Mm. And what we're trying to do with Ehtesab is that there is a fundamental human right to access information. That's really how society changes. When you know what's going on around you, you have the impetus and the desire to bring about change. And through Ehtesab, our main thing is keeping people informed, keeping people aware of what's going on, and also giving women a platform to speak freely, to speak with security. And one of the things we're working on right now for the Ehtesab app is a whisper campaign, which will provide an app that looks like a calculator or a menstrual app. But with that app, if a woman is going through her daily life and she has a situation where she's confronted with a talib, or she has issues of domestic violence, or any sort of issue that has created a barrier to her life after August 2021, that she's able to be given kind of like emergency safety card information that you'd see on a plane, information that's collated by women activists and researchers who have been in this field for over 20 years to say, if you're in the situation, here's something that you can do. If you're in the situation, here's some information you can give us to make sure that your story is heard, because right now, thousands of Afghan women are speaking, but no one is hearing them. Mm. And that's because we need to speak in a way that the world in 2023 will listen to them, and a lot of that is through data. And that's really the work that I do. As for what we can do and how we can support them, before I spoke today, I asked Supreme Court judges, Afghan women who were Supreme Court judges, I've asked prosecutors, diplomats, teachers, principals, professors about this, that I'm going to Women for Women International, and they're gonna ask me, how can we help you? And I also asked women, young women are currently in Afghanistan, I asked my team, five of them who are young women who are in Afghanistan, and they said a few different points. One was, do not legitimize the Taliban under any circumstance when they do not deserve it. Girls cannot go to school, they cannot go to work. Women have been barred in every single way possible. We are seeing a gender apartheid. We are seeing 50% of Afghan society disappearing from our eyes. Where is the sentiment here to even speak or engage with the Taliban? That is the first thing. The second thing is that we recently just had the Doha talks. And the outrage was, why aren't women there? Why are we having that outrage in the first place? That's the main thing. Women should have been a part of the organization process. For the Doha meetings for the UN, someone should have been there at the UN, and I also met a colleague from UN Women today, saying, wait a minute, there's literally no woman here on this delegation. How can we even go about speaking about women's rights in Afghanistan if there's literally no woman in the Doha delegation, which is the most important discussion we're gonna be having about Afghanistan? So that's when we have the outrage. But they are telling me, tell them, when you're organizing meetings, high-level meetings, is an Afghan woman there? Is someone there who has seen Afghanistan over the last 20 years who can actually speak about it? And that's not happening. For example, the special envoy to Afghanistan, Rina Amiri, who I adore, and that last day, she realized that there was gonna be no woman speaking between the UN Secretary General and others, and she quickly brought about 50 Afghan women leaders to speak on Zoom. And I appreciate that so much, but having women on Zoom versus actually seeing them in a table in front of the Taliban or in front of the UN Secretary General has a different type of feeling. Mm. It has a different type of strength. Having them on Zoom is, we checked that box, we had them there. Mm. And that's the concern, is that you're never gonna take women seriously, whether they're Afghan women or anyone, when they're actually not in the room. And that needs to happen, is that we can't just be a citation or a footnote in conversation. We have to be there, front line and center, speaking, because we know what we're doing. We just need to be given the platform to do that.
Absolutely, and I think that's a really good transition. Amjad, Women for Women has a team on the ground. Can you tell us what they're up to, please?
Yes, we've had an operation in Afghanistan from the time that the previous Taliban government fell. Mm-hmm. And when the fall of Kabul happened, we had a decision to make as an organization, as a board, what are we going to do? Obviously, the people that could be rescued, everybody was trying to rescue, but we obviously knew that there was going to be a country worth of people left that aren't going to be rescued and aren't going to be evacuated. And we made the decision that, you know, if we were able to work in Sarajevo during the siege, we should try to find a way of working in Afghanistan during this siege. And it's to the credit of our team and our model. I mean, we work as local organizations. We hire locals. Our staff are locals. And we establish relationships with community leaders. We work very hard to, you know, in Nigeria, you know, there was a practice called the widowhood practice, which punished women if their husband died before the spouse. And so the women in our program were really adamant about, you know, working to end this practice. And so we worked with local leaders until we got tribal leaders to agree that, a number of them to agree that they wanted to phase this out and they would work with the community to phase it out. So it's always been our model that we've worked with local leaders. And so our team was able to work with community leaders, with people who were benefiting from the program. And it's a very complex, you know, from the outside it's a monolith, it looks like a monolith, but on the inside it's a very fractured, complex system, and we've been able to work within that system to allow us to continue operating and with our female staff.
Yeah.
Now, it's hard because we want to stay there and we want to continue being on the ground. And at the same time, we want to continue promoting the values that we promote in every other country that we promote. And so the level of diplomacy that's being used by our staff, by the team here, by the leadership team of Women for Women, if the script writers for The Diplomat are, once the strike is over, are looking for storylines for next season, there is a lot in there about remarkably creative grassroots, on the ground, local diplomacy to try to continue the work. And so we're still there, and you know, we consider, when we think of Afghanistan, we think of it in the same way we think of Sudan and we think of Ukraine right now.
Yeah.
You know, as active conflict zones that need continued attention and continued assistance. And so, you know, we've of all the countries we've worked in, we've never actually left.
Yeah.
So we're still in Rwanda, you know, we're still in Kosovo, we have organizations in all these countries. We will do everything that we can to not leave Afghanistan.
And that's what's really powerful, is almost the generational relationships that you have on the ground.
Right.
So that you can pivot as, you know, conflicts, you know, unfortunately arise and they calm down, but you continue to do the work and your team is ready and are bringing others along. It's incredible. I want to open this up for Q&A. We have a roaming mic. This was an extraordinary amount of information and work that is being done on behalf of women around the world. And we'd love to hear your questions for the panelists. Oh, we have a speaker back there. Can you stand up? Because she's coming with the mic.
Thank you. Good afternoon, my name is Maya Sauceda. I'm a student at Columbia SIPA. And I'm here with my peers, and I think that's why I'm thinking in this question. Immediately, it came to my mind to think, what do you think it's the role of the academia, like in all the efforts for supporting women? Like, you know, we're students that are focusing on this topic, and I'm just wondering, like, what do you think that is missing there that we should be like talking about or learning about?
Thank you, it's a great question.
I'm happy to start because I'm actually headed, right after this, I'm headed back to my graduate school to talk, and I was joking, but I'm serious, like it is the scariest talk that I'm ever gonna have to give because they invested in me, they both invested their time and their teaching and all of that, but also money, right? I'm speaking to the board, and I have to sort of prove that I was worth the investment, and so I'm scared. I'm scared. Is that okay to say out loud? I'm scared. But I also think that the reason why I'm going is to ask them to do a little bit more too, right? Because they have so much untapped power. They have so many resources. They have students who want to do this work. They publish incredible things. So this really terrific article came out in Foreign Affairs last year by Zoe Marks, Professor Zoe Marks and Erica Chenoweth. And what it essentially says in it is that authoritarianism and misogyny, I mean, I just love this quote, are not common comorbidities. They are mutually reinforcing ills. I know. I mean, how beautifully put. That is not something that I would ever think of to say. So how can you as an academic, like, how can we build a bigger stage for you to say that? If you have the data to show that rollbacks on women's rights are not just accidental, and authoritarianism and rollbacks is not just accidental, how can you shout that a little bit louder? Because if data actually matters, if information actually matters, if truth actually matters, like, we need a bigger platform in all of this work for academia, and it can't just be exchanged in conferences. And frankly, even though I like foreign affairs, I don't even subscribe. I just use the State Department's website, right? Like, so that is a very niche audience. We need to find a bigger audience for these academics who care, and then we need to deputize their students to then become not all policymakers, but CEOs and media magnates. I think that there's a much bigger role for academia to play, and I hope that even if I'm scared tomorrow, I can say that out loud.
That's great. We have time for one more question. She's coming. She's over here. Yeah, we want everybody else to hear. Thank you.
This sort of piggybacks on the dynamic between authoritarianism and women's rights, but I would be curious to hear any of you talk about the situation in Iran right now, both with respect to what's happening on the ground and on a logistical level, how anything can be done on behalf of the brave and courageous people who are rising up against a very fierce regime, but also more broadly speaking about what it says that so little of the world is speaking up on behalf of women's rights, and that sends a message globally that when everything is on the line and women and men and children are willing to stand up and put everything on the line very publicly to protect themselves, no one else is standing up for them.
Well, I think one thing is, you know, first of all, standing in solidarity with the people that are actually, you know, leading the fight for freedom and in whatever context and whatever country they're in, including in Iran. But you know, I'm also, I have the same question as you do, like, how's the best way to do that and how's the best way to make that influence? One of the arguments we, Zainab and I used to make at the beginning of the organization, because sometimes people thought of what was happening in Bosnia or Rwanda as something that was happening in an alien context. That was something that was happening far away. It couldn't happen here. It didn't affect me. And we always tried to argue that an assault on women's rights in one place was actually eventually an assault on women's rights everywhere. Today, there are states in the United States that have more restrictions on female autonomy than some of the most draconian states in the Middle East, for example. And you wouldn't have imagined that, I couldn't have imagined that 30 years ago, even though if I would have made the argument, women's rights in one place are women's rights everywhere, it wouldn't, I probably had that American bias of being born and raised here that I never would have thought that things in the United States could slide backwards. And so, so I think that at least whether it's Iran, Afghanistan or anywhere else, letting people realize that we're fighting for ourselves as much as we're fighting for somebody else. It's not that we're just doing charity to help Iranian women or Afghan women, et cetera. It's a global struggle, and we're fighting on different fronts, but we're fighting the same war.
Thank you. That was the perfect place to conclude this panel. Thank you all so much for being here today.
Delaney Steele. Now to Delaney. Please join me on stage. She's an executive of Ross Stores and co-chair of the Women for Women International's Board of Directors. Thank you, Delaney, for joining us all the way from California to share more about the power of investing in women survivors. Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you, Penny, and thank you, Sara and Varina and Amjad. It was really informative and really fascinating. So I have not been involved with Women for Women for 30 years, like Zainab and Amjad, but it has been about 15 years since the first time I went to Rwanda and saw our programs firsthand. And what really moved me to stay involved in Women for Women at that time is the same thing that moves me today, which is our program actually really works. It really does transform the lives of a population who's often forgotten. So what really attracted me at first was the vocational and financial literacy, because, you know, I'm a business person and it was all about the ROI. But as someone who grew up with six sisters, what actually really blew me away was watching the power of that sisterhood you heard about. There's really something amazing about bringing 25 women together every week with that consistency. I mean, the way that these women's lives change, you know, at the beginning of the program, they're often very quiet, they're in despair, they're kind of excited about what the program might bring to their lives, but they're also very concerned and nervous. And at the end of the program, at graduation, they're loud. Lori was talking about all the dancing and the singing and supporting each other. So even though I'm a total data junkie and we have lots of data to back up our program, I've actually felt it and I've seen it firsthand. So I really do believe in it. The other thing I would say is, you know, we talked a lot about a lot of different countries. These are different contexts. But the one thing that's really, really consistent is that power of women coming together and learning together and supporting each other and often going into business together. I want to read a quote. This is a quote from a woman named Irina who works with us in Ukraine. She said, "When your house has been destroyed, your relatives killed, and it seems that life is over and darkness and evil surround you, it's important to offer a ray of hope, to show the dawn is coming soon, to extend a hand of support, and start taking the first steps towards a normal life together." So what also gives our participants hope and courage is knowing that someone in a very far away country like the US recognizes what's happening to them and wants to extend that hand of support. And that is more powerful than you might imagine, because many of our women are living in contexts where even their own families and communities don't necessarily value them. So another reason I'm really into Women for Women is because it keeps me grounded and helps me maintain my perspective. So I was thinking about this last week, because we lost power at our house and therefore internet for a day. And the amount of outpouring of support from my friends and colleagues was a little bit ridiculous. You know, and I was like, okay, let's keep this in perspective, everybody. We're not in Congo, we're not in DRC, there's no rebels running through our village at night, raping and pillaging. You know, when I was listening to Varina talk about Afghanistan, we're not in Afghanistan. We didn't one day show up at work wearing what we wanted to wear, and then the very next day we're hiding in our houses in fear. We can't work, we can't wear what we want to wear. In fact, we can't even travel without a male relative, fine if it's your one-year-old son. It's kind of crazy. That is gender apartheid, Varina said. We're not in that environment, but we can be compassionate and understand that's happening in other environments. So I really appreciate that it kind of keeps perspective for me. You know, and people talk about things like the mental health crisis in the US from COVID, which is very real. And I think about, wow, I can't imagine what it's like in Afghanistan with that level of isolation and oppression. So talking about Afghanistan for a minute more, I can't tell you how many people have said, it seems kind of pointless to work there, honestly. Like, isn't it a pretty hopeless situation? I don't think so at all. Now, I'm not saying we're going to change the government in Afghanistan, but I can tell you we can change people's lives, and very meaningfully. In August of 2021, I'm sure all of us in this room were absolutely glued to our TVs, watching people trying to escape. And as Amjad said, we had to make a decision. Are we actually going to try to stay? All the other NGOs seem to be leaving. Like, can we do this? I wasn't so sure. But our staff on the ground, our amazing staff on the ground, they were sure. They were basically like, this is what we do. We work in these impossible situations, and we must stay. Because everyone else is focused on everyone who's leaving the country, but there are a lot of people who don't have that opportunity, and they have to stay. So we are working in Afghanistan. In fact, we have 2,000 people enrolled right now. And one of them is named Salma. Salma has 5 kids. That alone, I think, sounds really hard. 5 kids, and she's the sole breadwinner of the family. And she is using the cash and the training that she has gotten through Women for Women to start a business in her home. And she's making a profit. And I haven't met her, but apparently she likes to tell people, I have a new life. And I love that. I think if my family can take our privilege and our resources, and we can help a family like Salma's have a healthier and a more joyful life, that's a win to me. And then I think about the ripple effects of her daughters and her sons seeing what she can accomplish, and they can believe that they can do that too. So I just want to end with one last message, which is what we do at Women for Women is unique. There aren't other organizations that focus on the intersection of war and women. It is unique. And as you heard Lori say, we want to impact not just thousands of women, but millions of women, which sounds ambitious, but it starts one woman at a time. And so my request for you is to consider being a part of offering that ray of hope. So you can make a donation today. As Lori said, we have QR codes, we have iPads if you want to wave someone down, we have envelopes, and I hope you'll consider making a donation. Thank you so much for that, and thank you so much for coming here.